a game comes in. So the better you deal with stuff up here, the better it'll you will be able to fulfill your potential, and that will be reflected in your performance. And for me, there's two ways to do that, and or there's just the one way, and that comes down to hope. For me, the big part of any performance comes down to, you know, you hear coaches say, you know, they didn't want it enough, or people say the especially the commentators and the news media refers to they're not hungry enough, they didn't want it enough, and that boils down to some discouragement somewhere. And again, we want people to fulfill their potential, and the moment you fulfill your potential, there's something happening, and for me that is to instill hope, to have hope that you will fulfill your potential. And hope means that you know how to fulfill your potential, one, and the second part is how that I know how to deal with interferences. And the moment you have hope in that, that's when things change. That's when there's a swift a shift in your approach to any game. And so the first part is that you need to know what you want, and then you deal with the interferences afterwards. And if I say you need to know what you want, that is that you need to know what you want and not what you don't want. And that's there's a huge difference, because part of the interference is when something happens that we say, I don't want this. I don't want this to happen. And the moment you say that, your focus shifts to that part. Like if I say, I don't want to tackle high, or we give the instruction to our players, you don't tackle high. The moment you say, don't tackle high, that's the picture you create in their minds. And somehow, it doesn't matter how many times they say, I don't want to tackle high, I don't want to tackle high. Every time, there's that picture popping up. So we need to convert the picture, because somehow if the picture sticks, then they end up doing that, because they don't think of that all the time. They play. And so somehow we need to shift that and to know what we want. So what do you, the first question is, what do you want when you don't want to tackle high? Is to say, I want to tackle low. And then the moment you say that, then that picture pops up, and that gives you a better chance. So that's part of fulfilling your potential, but then also dealing with the interferences. And dealing with the interferences, there's so many ways to deal with it. And maybe we can, if you tune into that video series that I'll be starting to post tonight, then you will. There we will deal with a couple of the tools to deal with the interferences. And the big part of dealing with the interference is just to get your mind back to the present. You see, for me, mental toughness is to be where you are, meaning that where you sit now and you listen to me, there can be many distractions or things that'll take your mind away from what we're talking about. And the moment, let's say you get a WhatsApp message and you start reading the WhatsApp message, then you will miss out on what we're saying here. Or anything like that, or someone walks into the room and just asks you something, then you missed out on a part here. And mental toughness is to stay in the present, because the time frames that we comprehend is the past, the present, and the future. So, and that's where our minds run to. When I say something that triggers maybe something emotional in you, then you will think back of a time that it happened, etc. And you can, if you accommodate that in your mind will run back to that part, and you will remember, you will go back there, and you'll miss out on what we're saying here. Or if let's say we go a little long, which I don't think we will, then we will jump to the future, and then you will miss out on what's happening now. And so there's that shift between the past and the future. And to get back to the present, that's where we live, and that's the only place we can make a difference. So if let's say you play a rugby game, this scrum taking place now, that's the only place you can be. And that your mind and everything, your body needs to be here, and not in the previous scrum, not in the future, we're going to win or not. You need to be in the present. Now, a big part of that being in the present is just this, that's the different techniques to come back in the present, because it's so difficult. If I missed three kicks in a row, the next kick, my mind will go back to the ones that I missed. So that's the way we use some of the tools to get back in the present so that you can do whatever you need to do to make the best use of your potential for this kick. And for that, you've got most of the control. If you just think, if you take a kick, how you place the ball is in your control. The angle, the etc. How you step back is in your control. Your body movement, your breathing, where you look, etc. That's all in your control. And up to the moment that you kick the ball, that's all under your control. It's only when the ball leaves your foot that you don't control it anymore. So we need to get your mind back to the parts that you can control, and that's the present moment. So, and that is mental toughness. But if your mind runs back to the previous kick, that's when you mess up the steps, when you mess up the placing of the ball, or where you focus, or you're in a rush, and that's when you mess it up. Now, that's why mental coaches are important, and mental conditioning is important, because this you can do beforehand. While you stand there, it's very, very tough not to think of the three kicks you missed. But if you decide now, when we sit before the game, in the week before the game, and we go through the scenarios and we say, okay, how are you going to handle this when this happens? What you're going to do when you miss three kicks? Then you have a point of reference, and that's where mental toughness comes in. It's not just about, it's not becoming really mentally tough. It's to know what to do at that moment without panicking. For me, that is mental toughness. That you're not panicking when you miss three kicks, but then that your mind will go, I can control everything else, etc. And I know how to kick. I know how to do this. I know how to fulfill this part of my potential. The interference is that. So I need to get back in the present. I need to do my pre-kick routine properly, etc. And that's what the best people can do. And that's why experience is so important, because you can pick that up through experience, but you can shortcut it by the mental conditioning. That you don't have to go through or lose 10 games by through your head running around and then learn it through experience. You can shortcut that by through mental conditioning to go to scenarios that you can deal with that properly. Now, a big part of that is the tool that I want to give you. And that is a tool from Institute in America. It's called the 3D Institute, and we formed a partnership with them, and we just started to distribute it here in South Africa, and it's really, really, really good. And I've got international Wilbur was on a Zoom call yesterday with a fitness coach in France. The scrum coach for Scotland Rugby was supposed to be there. He just couldn't make it. They had another meeting. And we had international rugby player from Namibia. He didn't play in Namibia. He lives in Namibia now. He played in France and for the Blue Bulls. So we had these guys on the call, and they all 100% in on this. Now, I would like to share some of this, because you can come on this. And this is a part that you will see now that's missing so many times with coaches. So I'm just going to jump to my screen here and share the screen with you. I don't know, is it on, Wilbur?
Yes, we can see it, Christo.
Okay, wonderful. Now, it's called three-dimensional coaching. Now, what it is, the first question I need to ask you if you're a coach then is, why do you coach? And you know, there's so many different answers, and if we had time, we could ask you why you coach. But that's a fundamental question, because most of the time, it's not about the money. It's not about someone forcing you. There's something in coaching that makes you tick. And then the second question: if you know why you coach, why do you coach the way that you do? And so many times, it's the way that you coach is the way that you got taught, or the way that you that you were coached by some other person and that you don't know better. That is the way that you were taught to coach. And then it's like a hypothetical question. What does it feel like to be coached by you? And that's an interesting one. If you could ask your players, what does it feel like to be coached by someone like you? Now, and then going with this is, what is your definition of success? Because that's a coaching philosophy by itself. Now, what the three-dimensional pyramid is about, you first get the fundamentals, then, and that's the first dimension. That's the physicality, and that's the body of coaching. And I'll explain it now very shortly. And then you get the psychology on the second level, and that's mostly what I did with teams. When I worked with teams and individuals, I work on the psychology, and that's the body and the mind. So the bottom one, you just work with the body. That's the physical part of the whatever game you're playing. And then the second one, that's the body and the mind. So a lot of the work I did was on that level. But then you get a third level, and that's the level of the heart. And that's the body, mind, and spirit. That's the holistic person. So, and now the fundamentals, that's things like strength, power, the cardiovascular speed, quickness, the technical parts. And so there's so many of these things, the repetition, the tactics, etc., that's on the first level. Now, the first level is what, if you're a coach, that's what you're doing. And that's what almost 100% of the coaches spend their time with. And the sad thing is, the American research shows that 80% of the of coaches, between 70 and 80%, only coach on this level. This is what you do. Now, the thing is, you can win championships on if you do this level well. But there will always be relationship issues. There'll be unhappy people around, because you're not tapping into the full the holistic person itself. The athletes become performance tools. They just need to perform the way that you want them to. Now, so then if we move on to the next part, then you get to go to the second dimension, and that's motivation, confidence, emotions, team cohesion, goal setting. And that's the important things that it's not just, okay, guys, you need to do 100 push-ups. Why do we need to do that? And the moment there's a goal setting, not just winning, but the goal setting, a clearer goal setting for the practices, etc., then you move on a different level. You step up to the next level. And the research in America shows that 10% of coaches move on that level. So then you get the 80% on the first level plus the 10% more or less on this level. That and people talk about that natural motivator, or people that instill confidence, etc., and or deal with the emotions of players. And we see the great coaches. We've seen that with Rossi Erasmus now with the World Cup. If you look at the comments, then people talk about how he motivated people, how he instilled confidence in the team, how the team cohesion came together. So it wasn't just about fitness or strength on the first level. They had goals, clear goals set out for everything, or on and off the field. So you see how they moved on this level. But then if we move to the third dimension, and that's the dimension of the heart, because that's when you get to the real core of the players, and that you involve the players about their identity, their character, their significance, the self-worth, and the value, and their purpose. And if you think of what Rossi did, he moved on this level where very few coaches do. He challenged the guys. If you guys probably, if you're into rugby, you probably saw the videos, the clips that were shared afterwards, of how he talked about their identity, who they are. Does rugby identify them? Are they only rugby players, or who are they? And then their character on and off the field. Significance, he talked about how significant this will be for the country, how significant will this be for their families. And the self-worth they will get from this, the value they'll bring to South Africa. The purpose of this wasn't just for the team. It wasn't just for the money. It wasn't that there was a bigger purpose. So he touched their hearts, meaning that he could tap into the whole meaning. It wasn't just about how fit and how strong, etc. They were. So you see the value of this, and we have this great example with the rugby team. So now if we go to this, the three dimensions, all three dimensions are necessary. So, and we, the third dimension unlocks the full person, and you get the best out of your players. So if we look at the results of 3D coaching from America, and it's been going on there, and you can have a look at the website. There's lots of testimonies, etc. Athletes learn skills quicker. They're more attentive because you touch their hearts. They achieve higher fitness compliance. They work harder because it's not just about getting fitter. There's a bigger purpose to that. They experience shorter rehabilitation, the injury recovery, more adaptable to new conditions. They process freedom to be creative. And they can be there, they can fulfill that potential I talked about in the beginning. And they developed a deeper relationship with other players and coaches. So it's about relationship, and they learn life lessons. So now it's all about goals versus purpose. And where goals are specific events that take place within a specific time, and then purpose gives meaning to and mission to that, and a legacy and a love. So, and that's just tapping into that. Now, the 3D framework requires a foundation. So you need to build a foundation. And now we can use the American foundation, because those of you that's been to America, most of the houses have a solid foundation, but they build everything with wood. So this comes from them. But we need every coach needs a transformational purpose statement. And then when you use that statement to build your coaching on, like in that picture. Now, here's my transformational purpose statement. For me, it's to inspire coaches and athletes to pursue excellence in sport and in life with courage and passion while enjoying the journey. And that's, for me, that is what drives me. I want to inspire coaches and athletes. I want them to pursue excellence in sports, but not only in their sport, but also in life. Because it's no use you're this great athlete, but you're a jerk in life, and you mess around with your wife and your family, and you treat your kids like whatever. And you need to pursue that excellence with courage and with passion. Now, courage is an interesting, we talk about getting discouraged. And the moment something happens, people get discouraged. And that's actually there where the courage steps in. Because it's not like mentally tough guys don't get discouraged. The moment something happens, of course, your mind shifts to the discouragement. But then you need to remember it takes courage from there to get back and then to start focusing on something else. So you do it with courage. And then the moment you know what you want, remember I said that's the first part of instilling hope. The moment you say, I want to show courage in this situation and I want to move forward, that's when you instill hope. And then that hope immediately, and you know what you want, instills passion or builds passion in you. And then you can enjoy the journey. It's not just about the winning. It's about enjoying the journey. So, and that's the wonderful thing about the 3D course. So, now, just a question. Have you ever written a transformational statement for your coaching? And do you have strategies in all those dimensions to fulfill this? And the thing is, what legacy are you going to leave as a coach? Because it's not just about winning a tournament. The guys, I've been with teams that won tournament championships, and then they come afterwards and says, "Is this all there is? Because now we need to start working on the next one." And it's just that moment of celebration if you don't enjoy the whole journey. But then it's when they win, they were good. And if they lose, it's the coach. But if you work on the all three dimensions, you leave a legacy as a coach, because you touch their hearts, and the lessons they learn there, they take into life. And Wilbur will know the guy that from Namibia last night. He played for the Blue Bulls, for Springbok Sevens, for in France a long time. And he said he wants to get this to the kids so that they know their athletic career can end in a split second, but they need to learn the lessons, or the lessons they learn, they can use that for the rest of their lives. So this is so important. And a guy, Billy Graham, said, one coach will impact more people in 1 year than the average person does in a lifetime. And that's the impact of the coach. Because these guys from the 3D Institute, they say the two most important words for any athlete is coach said. Coach said. And, you know, if you, especially school learners, if coach said something, that's the law. So how we do it, how we say it, is so important. So I wanna challenge you guys. You can go and have a look. You can have a look at the 3D Institute, the website 3dinstitute.com. There's also a Facebook page and on Twitter. But the important part is the website. There you'll see different courses. At the moment, they made the administrators course for free, and that's mostly for administrators. So if you know any administrators, direct them there and get them in touch with me, and you will see there's different courses, but there's elementary course, but the big course that we are pushing now is the accreditation course, that you get accredited afterwards, and the cost at this stage is $125, which in South African rands is like a trillion with the exchange rate. We made a deal with the 3D Institute, so we can actually give the course of $125. That's on the website. If you work through me, you can do it for 500 rand. And instead of, it's over 2,000 rand at the moment, if you do it through them. So we in South Africa, we can do it for about 500 rand. It's a full course. It is amazing. And if you you can have a chat to me, and you can contact me for anything in South Africa. You can email me on Christo@christospeace.com or cspeace. My first letter, just the C for Christo, and Spies my surname, at 360globalsport.com. So you can send me an email, or then if you have my phone number, you can just WhatsApp me or talk to me, and then I can we can have a chat about this, and I can guarantee you this is something worthwhile. This is something that it's definitely something that you can take up, and that's a way to become really mentally tough. That's a way to take your coaching to the next level. Now, I don't know if there's any questions. Wilbur, I can't see any of you. I don't know. Oh, there you are. Okay, I'm back. Okay. I don't know if there's any questions or anything that you guys would like to ask or want to know. Then we can go into a time of question and answers. Or, like I said, if you want to ask anything else, not on the group, then you can just contact me later on.
Okay, guys, we're going to open for questions. And I think is when you want to ask a question, just for order of purpose and just to manage it, I think just indicate in the comment section that you want to ask, and then I'll give you opportunity to speak. So is there anyone that want to open up? Okay, Christo, I'm gonna start it off. There's a lot of uncertainty if we'll have sport this year. From a mental perspective or mental performance coach, how do you keep players motivated through this time?
Yeah, Wilbur, when I learned early on in the mental game that I can't motivate players. That's motivation from outside. If players really want to do something, it needs to come from within. So what I've done in the past is I get the player to tell me his goals. So let's say, let me give you an example. When I worked with a cheetah rugby team, I say, okay, what do you guys want? So I sit with them individually and we map out their goals. So let's say the guy says, I want to play for the Springboks. So now he's written it down and that's his goal now. And then we break it down to the game plan and to performance goals, the process goals. But then now he doesn't practice the way he should. He's happy where he is in the cheetah team. So what I do now, when he's not performing the way he should, then I call him in and say, okay, listen, you said you want to play for the Springboks, but you've just picked up a bit of weight. You're not doing all the exercises you said you want to do. So let's change this. Instead of saying play for the Springboks, let's say, okay, I just want to be in the cheetah team. And normally they say, no. So so you either change the goals or you change what you're doing. Now, I think in this time it's the same. We need to sit down with players and we say, okay, what do you want? What do you want the moment that when the season starts again or when we resume with normal time or whatever? And to get them to say, okay, this is what I want. I want to be fitter than ever. And if I say I want to be fitter than ever, then we say, okay, what are you going to do? Is what you're doing lining up with your goals? And so they need to know what they want and then take it from there. So I think a big part of motivation will be intrinsic motivation of what they want afterwards. And that's just shifting your mind to what you want and then break it down to process goals. What am I going to do today so that I can get that? It's like my purpose statement. The moment I feel a little, should I be doing this? Then I go back to my statement. I want to inspire coaches and athletes to pursue excellence and in sport and in life with courage and passion. And then suddenly that fires me up. And so what I do in a better way because I'm intrinsically motivated.
Okay. Thanks, Christo. We've got a question from Charlie. So just to give you a bit of background on Charlie, Charlie's a South African. He's currently coaching in the U.S. So you ask, where does emotional intelligence or self-awareness fall into the 3D coaching pyramid?
I think that's important. I think that's in the second part and in the heart, because the emotional, that's part of your identity. And if you look at the 3D, the top, the heart, it's about identity, self-worth. And that's that you become aware of that part. On the first level is just the body. Then the second part is the body and the mind. So a part of that will be in the body and the mind. But I think most of it will be on the third level where you get the of who you are and how do you act from that level. Because if you're just a rugby player, you'll act just from there. But if you say, let me use the example as a Christian, then who am I in Christ? Because that makes a difference for me as a Christian, but also as a player, who am I, how I see myself, not just as a rugby player, but as a person who is successful in life.
Okay. Is there any other questions? I've got a couple, so if no one's going to ask, I'll ask. So in a South African context, just from a South African context, why are we so reluctant or against appointing performance coaches? Or mental performance coaches?
I never understood it, but Ian McIntosh, that coached the Natal Sharks and the Springboks, he sat down with Adrian Strauss and myself at one stage when he was the convener of the Springbok rugby team at that stage. And Adrian Strauss wanted to know why he was left out of the team. And as we sat down there, he told us a story of how what got him sacked as the Springbok coach were the Afrikaans guys in the Springbok team, because they were used to, or the culture at that stage was that when you lose, you have to have like a trap session. You have to chop off on Monday. You have to do fitness, and you have to shout at them and scream at them, etc. And that's what they were used to. And he tried to break that. He said, no, there must be a better way to this. And the guys couldn't handle that. And he got sacked. And he said at that stage, he drew in Ray Jennings' brother, Ken Jennings. And that was the first guy sort of who worked on the mental side in rugby. And he said the guys couldn't handle that. And I think in a big way, that is it. We think, and if you think of most coaches, that's why the 3D is so important. Because the moment you lose or the moment you're not doing well, where do we go? We go back to the first level. And you can't solve a second level or a third level problem on the first level. You can't solve an identity problem by getting them fitter and stronger. You can't solve anything on that a motivational level on getting fitter and stronger. That needs to be done on the second level or the third level. And I think that's where people and that whoever appoints the mental conditioning coaches or whoever the administrators, they don't understand. They think you must just train harder and get fitter and get stronger or get a better game plan or get another coach, instead of realizing it's like what Andre Forsted said yesterday, Wilbur, the fitness coach in France. He said he realized the mistakes he made with top players, that he was very hard on them to train harder. And now he realized he missed their hearts. He needed to get to their hearts first, and then it's a lot easier to get them to train. Any other questions? Wilbur, I see you're on mute.
Sorry, I wanted to, Charlie, I forgot to unmute myself. So Charlie asked another question. It's a follow-up to link to his previous question on emotional intelligence. What, in your opinion, is the most important personality traits in a coach? And then he also commented that Andre coached him at under 19 level and broke his heart every session.
Yeah. It's interesting now. If you see Andre now, it's a different person, and he wants to come back to South Africa and promote the 3D. So he's had a change of heart. Yeah, I think that is tough. Just tell me what is Charlie coaching now? Charlie, what are you coaching now?
He's coaching rugby in the US. Charlie, you can speak to yourself.
Sorry, fellas, I just unmuted myself there. How's it, Christo? How are you doing?
Yeah, good, Charlie. And you?
Good. Good, thanks. So I played professionally in the USA. I'm South African, though, and now I've moved into coaching. I've been coaching full-time the last 2-3 years. I'm currently coaching. My primary job is the head coach of the University of San Diego. And obviously, I've just come in, so I've only been there 6 months, and it's not a big rugby school, as in it's not a big rugby program. So I'm able to start from the bottom. And I think the most important thing I've realized or I've noticed is that I've got to get to know these guys. I've got to get to know them on a personal level, just in order to get the best out of them. Because naturally, their skill sets aren't very good because they haven't played rugby for very long. So you've almost got to expedite the learning process. But my biggest challenge is, how do I figure these guys out? How do I get to know them so that I can help them get better as quick as I possibly can? So my question ideally was, what do you think is the most important personality trait in a coach?
I think what you're doing is moving on to the second and third level. And I think that most important, any skill or knowledge, you can Google and pick that up. You can learn almost anything. Yeah. But very few people learn people skills, and that's something that I think a lot of coaches. I just want to jump to a story. I'm working with one of the ex South African Springboks that's playing in France, and then he gets selected as they have the newspapers there, or they choose a team of the week. Then he's in the team of the week for his performance on Saturday, but then the coach sidelines him and jumps on him, swears at him how useless he is and how pathetic he is, and this guy can't handle it emotionally. So I think the coaches, you know, all the skills and techniques and stuff you can learn, and that's what the 3D is about, to help coaches realize that they need to get to the person. And that's wonderful that you already that you realize that too. And I think that's the best quality at the moment. And I think that's what Andre said last night, is that that's what he didn't do, and that's what he's going to do in the future, is get to the people, get to know the person. And the moment you get to know them and they get to know you, that builds the team cohesion as well, and that's also on the second level. So the moment then it's not just about individual performance, but it's about a team cohesion, because they get to know each other, and that doesn't mean they have to like each other and be best buddies, but they know each other and they work together to get the best out of what they're doing.
Awesome. Thanks, Christo. And yeah, I completely agree. And it's almost what comes quite naturally to us as South Africans, having been brought up playing in team sports and playing rugby, is that we almost gain an uncanny awareness of being a team person, or being a good bugger, as it were, and knowing what to say and what not to say and that sort of thing, which doesn't come naturally to a lot of Americans, because their team sports aren't the same, and their coaching, the way they coach isn't the same. And a lot of it's all about winning, 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 you know, parents are all about winning, winning, winning. And they completely miss the point in developing people and developing the individual. So, I really like this. So thanks for answering that, Christo.
Oh, wonderful. Thanks, Charlie. Good luck in San Diego.
Thanks, mate.
Okay, we've got another guy on the line that's from America. I don't know if Oliver, Oliver, can you hear me? Oliver?
Yes, hello?
Yes, so is there any questions from your side?
Yeah, actually, we're just typing one down. Thank you, Christoph, for having this. Definitely learning a lot. My question was, how would you recommend keeping hope or instilling hope more from a player perspective? When the interference starts to come up, and it's when it's more physical, maybe injuries or outside interferences.
Oliver, where are you, and what are you coaching?
I'm in the U.S. 20 years old. I'm still a player, but I do a little bit of coaching. Coach the eighth graders. Coach a little bit of high school.
What sport?
I've coached rugby and wrestling.
Okay. And the guys that developed the 3D course are all wrestlers. From the American teams. Okay, wonderful. Okay, and where are you in the U.S.?
Southern California, Los Angeles.
Okay. Now, for me, instilling hope, there's always the two elements. And the first element is always, what do you want? You know, even with injuries, when the teams I work with, when someone gets injured, then I normally sit with them and say, okay, what do you want now? And, you know, immediately they go to, maybe we lose our contract. What if the player that comes into my place is better than I, or performs better, and I'm struggling, I'll struggle to get back into the team. You know, there's all those things, and your mind can wander off quickly. But the mental tough players, I remember in the Cheetahs, when Heinrich Brasseau had a serious injury, when he came out of anesthetics, he was still sort of drowsy. And when I sat with him and I said, what do you want? And he had fishing trips lined up, hunting trips lined up, time with his girlfriend, etc. Things that he never gets time for. And immediately that was on a different level, because so knowing what you want, even in injury, even in everything, that's the first step to say, okay, you're injured now, we'll deal with that now. But first, what do you want? What do you want from this time that you're going to be off? You're not going to be able to work out or to practice the way that the other players practice. But then you say, okay, I'm going to do my rehab, because players don't do their rehab properly because they don't know what they want. They don't know what they want after injury, and they don't know what they want during the recovery process. So to break it down, afterwards, I want to come back fitter and stronger. I want this leg to be stronger than before, and I don't want to neglect my other leg or whatever it is. So that's not for me to decide. They need to come up with that, and they're very good with that. So they break it. We break it down, and then we say, okay, this, how are you going to do this? And then the time, the free time, how are you going to spend that? Because it's not just for TV games. What are you going to do in this time that can build? Are you going to read something? Are you going to speak to ex-players? Are you going to find out or sit with me as a mental conditioning coach and see where's the areas that we can work on, like scenarios? If this happens on the field, what can we do? And et cetera, et cetera. So again, it comes down to what do you want, and then breaking it down, and then say, okay, but now I'm injured, and then to say, okay, because of the injury, I can't do this and this, but I can still do this. And the moment you have something to do, that instills hope. Even I went through that with a guy in the UK now, ex-Springbok player in the UK, broke his finger. And we had to sit down, and he was really down and out. Until I said, but you know, your wife always complains that you never go anywhere in England, even though you're there. And suddenly it sort of opened up a new world for him. Now they can actually do certain things that they couldn't do before because he's injured. And so knowing what you want is a huge, huge, huge motivator. You know, Glenn, John Maxwell said, hope in the future gives you power in the present. Because the moment you know what you want, even whether you don't know whether it's possible or not, but it empowers you now to actually get going with it.
Yeah, thank you. That was an awesome answer.
Okay, thanks, Oliver. Charlie, you can go.
Let me pull up my question here. Christo, who's the most mentally stable, tough player you've ever worked with, and why? I'll be a little bit more specific just to help you. Which sportsman or athlete have you ever worked with where you thought, shit, this guy's, he's got his shit together emotionally and mentally?
Rugby player, there's two players. Heinrich Rousseau. He's on a different level. He's crazy. He's like, he's dealt with so much in his life. Heinrich Rousseau. And John Smith, that used to play for Springboks and Toulouse, the same. You know, he tore his Achilles heel, and then it got healed. It took a year. He came back. The first game he played, a couple of minutes, it went again, and again he went through almost a year, and then eventually. He got a trial period in France, and then he became another star. So he was just as mentally tough. He was amazing. So, and they played a big role, making my job a lot easier. At the Cheetahs, 2007 to 2009, they made my job so easy because they, every time we worked on something mentally, they just jumped in and they were saying, we need to do this, etc. So cricket players, I think the guy that I worked with that's mentally, or that bought into that is Mornay van Wyk. He was very unlucky not to play more for the Proteas. He was... because he was kept out by Mark Boucher, and at one stage he was a better batsman and keeper than Mark Boucher, but then he's one of them. And then David Miller, my favorite cricket player to work with is David Miller. He's just, you know, he goes through so many things and gets written off about stuff, and people don't always realize that he's batting to the orders from the coach or whatever, and he's a team man. So he won't go out there and just protect his wicket if they say you need to do this and this. So yeah, but he's I love him to bits.
Awesome. Just a follow up on Heinrik Brasseau there. So obviously, in a lot of guys' opinions, I mean, he should have played 100 games for the Springboks, yeah. And obviously came down to opinion of coaches and whatnot. How did he deal with that emotionally? Was that an issue for him? Knowing yeah. that he was good enough on merit, but it was just down to the opinion of the coach, and how did he deal with that and continue to keep performing?
No, you know, he like I said, he had luckily rugby wasn't his life; it was just a part of his life, and that's what okay. makes it a person mentally tough as well. His identity wasn't in rugby. He's one of the guys that studied while he played. And which people say is not possible. He studied quantity surveying. He got a degree while playing for the Cheetahs and for the Springboks. So he obtained a degree, and so that's part. He had this longtime girlfriend that he married, and they just had a baby now. So he had a life outside with in his relationship, and she's not the biggest rugby fan. She's a singer, so he had a life in that sense. He had a life he had good friends. Richard Strauss, his buddy, that's they were like twins, the same size. Yeah. Richard Strauss that played for Ireland. They were both, you know, Richard got a bad hand at the Cheetahs as well, and then eventually ended up playing for Ireland. And so he had these good friends on the other hand, and then he's mad about hunting and fishing and stuff, and he made time for that in between. So his life wasn't taken up by rugby, although that was the very important part of it. So he got really pissed off when people said that, or he's an emotional guy. But then he put that aside, worked towards the next thing, go on a hunting trip, comes back and just go for it.
Okay, so you'd say essentially he had good balance in his life, and he was able to sort of compartmentalize specific scenarios and put them away and focus on something else. And that's how he dealt with the majority of his setbacks.
That it wasn't only rugby. I've worked with others. I won't mention names, but I've worked with other guys who went into in injury, and they in the end, they're so depressed and they go through so many that they never come back. And I can mention two or three that's really sad cases. We were really up there, and after an injury or a setback or a wife leaving them or girlfriend leaving them, then it's, you know, how can they leave them? They're famous, they're a rugby player, but their identity is in the rugby, and not they don't have other things in their lives.
Yeah, brilliant. Cool. Thanks, Christo.
Christo, we're going to wrap it up now. So, and before you wrap it up, just to take our message. So, so the next 2 weeks, we also got a few speakers lined up. So next week, Yusuf Voyad, he's a sports hunter at the Bulls, will come and share with you guys. Just looking at latest strengths and strength and conditioning, how we can apply it in an amateur setup. And then the week after that, Vaynant Ellis just confirmed about 10 minutes ago that he's the performance analyst of the Golden Lions. He will come and present on the 21st of April. And then, Christo, I want to thank you for coming on board. It's always nice hearing you chat from and share some of your experience. I think that is great. And it's also nice to see how passionate you are about, because I was looking at your facial expressions while you spoke about players, how passionate you are about what you're doing. And I want to also leave you with something. I think keep on instilling on people and keep on developing passionate people as well. So, and keep on doing what you're doing. And then I want you to ask, want you to give us just, let's say, 3 pointers, take home message that is important for us as coaches from a mental and then also how to develop players holistically.
I think, first of all, help players be who they are. So many times we try to change players, but to be the best they can, you know, people, players get chosen for their strengths, not their weaknesses. And so many times we get players to work only on their weaknesses. So I think help players to be who they are and to know what they want with what they've got. one of the lessons I learned from losing my leg is it's not what you lost, it's what you have left that counts, and what you do with what you have left. And I think that's what I would like you to leave you with. What's in your hands? What are you doing with what's in your hands? And know, first of all, as a coach, what do you want? And those questions are asked in the beginning. Why do you coach, and why do you coach the way you coach? And then see, what do you want? And if you say you want to get to more to the players' hearts, contact me and we'll get you on the 3D course.
Okay. Thanks, Christo. Thanks for again sharing and loving your passion as well. And then thanks, guys. Thanks for coming out. Special thanks to Oliver that joined us for the first time, and then Charlie from far. Then also I wanna make a special mention of my good friend Norman Jordan, who's also a former Springbok, current Marty's coach. Thanks for coming out, and hopefully in the future we can also listen to you. So thanks, guys. Thanks, and enjoy your evening. And if you're celebrating Easter, enjoy Easter, spend it with your time and celebrate it for the right reasons. I know it's a bit difficult, you can't get your family, but do celebrate it, and then stay blessed and keep on impacting lives. So, thanks, guys.
Thanks, Doc. Well.
Thanks, Wilbur. Cheers. Thank you so much.
Enjoy your evening. Okay,
bye.
Bye.